Hello everyone and welcome to another live expert interview. My name is Lucy Challenger and I'm the CEO of Polo and Tweed, and I am joined today by Costis Frangoulis, who is the founder and CEO of Franman Limited. Hello Costis, how are you?
Hello Lucy, hello from sunny and warm Athens.
Oh, I'm so jealous, although the UK is a little bit warm today, so so the sunshine is coming our way it seems. But for everyone who's tuned in, I will give full transparency that me and Costi are wonderfully related. He is my very, very talented and skilled and very handsome uncle, and lives in Athens. Now, Costi has this incredible background, which I really wanted for him to share with everyone. So Costi, perhaps you could share to all our listeners your background and your amazing career that you've had to date.
Okay, thank you, Lucy. I started in business when I was in my early 20s. I was about 22 after I finished my studies and my military service. It was something I always wanted to do. And I got involved in the shipping industry. And I started a company which was representing makers from the shipbuilding equipment industry. And it grew up as a trading house. A trading house is more a term more familiar to Japan and Japanese people in the industry, because it's a company that does many kinds of services, offers a big number of services in the shipping industry. Like I mentioned in the beginning, shipbuilding equipment, ship repairing, new building contracting, consultancy work, trading of equipment, security management, different services and equipment that a ship and a shipping company needs.
Okay.
So I've been in this industry for almost 3 decades. My company has a leading role in this market, both in Greece and also in international markets. And from the very early steps of the company, we focused on the Far Eastern and Chinese markets. We started from Japan, then we moved to South Korea, and then China. So this is like the three countries where most of our business comes from. And of course, this is the three big countries for shipbuilding and equipment in this industry.
Okay, so obviously setting up a business and developing it takes a lot of work. I know, you know, but what was it that particularly drew you to this industry? Did you have a passion for the shipping industry to begin with? What was it personally that drew you to it?
Well, I guess it's in our DNA for Greeks, because it's our big industry. We have two big industries in our economy. One is shipping and the other is tourism. But shipping, we've been involved since the ancient years, and I'm proud to say that Greece is number one nation in ship owning, ahead of Japan and China. So this is a very big accomplishment. Mm-hmm. We have a fleet which is worth more than 100 billion euros, and it's a very, very big industry in my country. And of course, I don't think there's one single family in Greece who is not in either way involved in this industry.
Yeah.
And of course, I have to say that my father, my grandfather, and my great-grandfather were captains. So it's something that runs in the family.
Yeah, it's in the blood, it's in the DNA. And so do you enjoy being, I mean, the Greek waters we know are famous for being swimming, being on them. Do you enjoy sort of going out for fun onto the water? Is that a passion of yours?
Yeah, this is the sea is a passion for me for sure. And that's why, apart from my business in shipping, I also love pleasure boats and power boats. And it's also a side business in my company. So, you know, living in Greece, it has to be a passion. It wouldn't be logical not to be.
And so how do you, as an entrepreneur, as a business leader, you know, you have a big team that work for you and around you, you know, how do you keep evolving the business? How do you keep that competitive edge? What do you sort of How do you approach that?
Well, it's a good question. I think that when you are for a very long time in one business, you need to keep developing. You need to offer new services. You cannot stay the same. If you stay the same, you are out of business. You have to find ways to involve and progress and find new services that can be very interesting to your clients. And that's all the companies, they have to focus in doing this. It's not easy. You cannot achieve it always, but that's I think that's part of our success. We were able that during the years to keep adding new services to our clients, and I think that's something that the market needed, and it helped us grow.
Yeah, and so obviously, I mean, with this development, this evolution that you talk about, you're dealing with deadlines, you're dealing with targets, you're dealing with quite major projects, and you're working all the time in potentially quite a pressurized environment. So discretion becomes quite a major part of this, and confidentiality. But how do you approach that in the way that you run the business and, you know, explore new ideas whilst always respecting that at the heart of it?
Well, it's something that you have to pay a lot of attention. Mm-hmm. And as you said, confidentiality and discretion is very important, because here you deal with a number of multi-million projects that you work at the same time. You deal with very large corporations, with big shipyards, with very big and important ship owners. So you have to be extremely careful, because otherwise, if you don't have the trust, if you are not able to trust, to gain this trust, then you cannot go very far. So you have to be absolutely very, very careful with, when it comes to passing around information and keeping information for yourself, and of course, through the company.
Yeah. So if someone was listening to this and thought, I'd really like to work in the shipping industry in some regard, you know, is there any advice that you could say to people who are perhaps, you know, graduating school or graduating university and wanted to get into the world you specialize in? Is there any advice you could give to them?
Well, the advice is to, first of all, I want to say that's a very, very interesting industry. It's also very rewarding if you produce good results. You have to be passionate about it. You have to love it. You have to dedicate and commit yourself. Mm. You have to work very hard. But you can have you can have success in quite reasonably early stages. Yeah. You don't have to be very old. You can do that quite young, if you are like, say, a stockbroker. So, you know, all it is for me, and that's the advice always to give, is give all yourself, give 100%, and whatever you do, you can do it with great success.
Yeah, yeah, it's nice.
It's a very, very interesting industry.
Yeah.
It has a lot of sectors where someone can be involved. Even a career at sea, today with a modern fleet and modern ships, things are much easier than it used to be. In my father's time, you used to travel for 4 years straight, 3-4 years straight. Now you travel for 6 or 8 months, and then you're back. You stay a couple of months and you start again. And it's quite rewarding also as a profession.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Well, as you know, my grandfather and relative of yours travelled overland at one point. I mean, he was on destroyers in the war, in the Second World War, and then travelled overland with his family from Australia to England. And I believe it took him 4 weeks. And my mum always remembers that journey of being stuck on this boat for 4 weeks. And so she's definitely not a sea person. But like you say, the industry's clearly evolved to give a slightly better work-life balance, but it can be hugely rewarding if you love the sea, and you know, you have these different skills, be it, you know, computer minded, engineer minded, all these different things that the industry has to offer. And just going back to sort of, you touched on discretion and confidentiality, and without obviously talking about anything that we shouldn't do, can you think of any funny or unusual stories in, I mean, your 30 years of working in this industry that you could share with our listeners?
Well, I think there are many. I cannot remember one specific right now, but one thing that one thing that was very common for me, because I started very young, in my early 20s, when I started dealing with Japan and being big Japanese corporations, the fact that I was so young, it was in a very conservative business environment like the Japanese, that was a bit awkward sometimes, and they would be quite reluctant at the beginning, and you know, what's this young guy fellow doing here? But I think whatever the age, doesn't matter if you are able to prove that you are, you know, capable, and they can trust, and someone who can produce results, they will accept it. But I think the funny part is that, you know, for them, me being in my early 20s was a bit, they felt a bit awkward about that.
Yeah.
Well, because the big CEOs were in their 60s, late 60s, early 70s. You can imagine.
And then you rocked up and you're like, hi, let me tell you some things. So in my line of work, as you know, a lot of our clients own and crew super yachts, mega yachts, which are obviously more of a domestic, you know, private industry. But for listeners, you know, are these boats and vessels different to the ones you work with, and sort of what are the key differences?
Well, we work mostly with in merchant shipping with ocean-going vessels. So we're talking about tankers, bulk carriers, container ships, LNGs, LPGs, cargo ships in general. The yacht industry is a different industry. Of course, most of our clients, they own large mega yachts, but that's another thing. So it's a completely different. We, in our business, the ships that we deal with, they carry goods around the world 24 hours a day for almost every day of the year. And it's completely business. The other has to do with pleasure. Yeah. It's another industry, very important industry, also big in Greece, but completely different.
Yeah. And so if someone was listening to this and thinking, you know, they want to work in the shipping industry, they want to work in that area, is training important? You know, should they study? Will that help them with their career?
Yeah, training is something that you must, of course, you have to study. You need to have some educational background. Of course, I'm not one who believes that in order to succeed in life, you need a number of degrees. I think the most important factor is to be a smart, capable person, hardworking, and you can achieve anything. But of course, having an educational background is important. And of course, while you are a professional, you need to continue training and learning things and skills, because it's extremely important. And that's something that I do it with my team continuously, because they need to be ready all the time to offer their best. And in order to do that, as an athlete, and you know from athletes and champions, they need to train regularly and very hard. And that's, it's no different, no difference in business. It's exactly the same.
Yeah, absolutely.
And you have to increase your skills, learn new things, become better. All the time. You know, you can never say, I know everything. For example, last week I took a special seminar for negotiations.
Okay.
I've been negotiating all my life. I believe that this is my hard point. I feel I'm a good negotiator, but you never know everything. And you know, if you can develop, you have to develop. Even at my age, no. you have to keep going.
Yeah. And I think that's also so enlightening about training and self-development, you know, whether you do it for your career or you do it for your own mind. You know Jason, my grandfather, he's still studying age 97. You know, he does his degrees and he learns something new because he enjoys that self-development and self, you know, enlightenment, for want of a better word. And I think particularly now we're faced with this world pandemic and we have limited access to physically go places, you know, e-learning, online training, seminars that you mentioned, you know, these are all amazing ways for people to gain more information and to expand their mind and their horizon.
Yes, and at those times, e-learning and e-communicating like we do now is of utmost importance, because you don't have other ways. And during this pandemic, we all learned that life is going to be different from tomorrow.
Yeah.
And new things. We're going to get accustomed to new things that we learn during this lockdown, like, for example, meeting via Zoom or Teams.
Yeah.
And this is something that will continue.
Yeah.
Of course, I believe that dealing live in person cannot be substituted by no Zoom call, but Zoom call can be complementary and can assist a lot. You see, I was reading this morning that Cambridge, University of Cambridge, decided that until summer 21, they're going to continue with online classes.
Wow.
Which is it's amazing to hear that from Cambridge. And of course, I don't think it's a very good decision, because at those times, leaders like Cambridge is in the education field, they need to take more brave decisions, because it's very, very easy to say today that we're going to continue staying at home. And but it's very important for the psychology of the people, for leaders and leading organizations to come out and fight this pandemic and be more optimistic, because the global economy needs to start again and restart, and we cannot continue this lockdown, and we cannot have a second lockdown,
yeah,
as some people are expecting. We have to avoid this, because we cannot have 2020 pass just like this. Things have stopped working in many countries for a very long time, and this is extremely bad, and it has to change. It cannot continue forever.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. I imagine that, you know, Cambridge, like universities and, you know, schools, you know, there's so many international students all around, you know, that the logistics of teaching people when they're not in the country as well becomes really challenging. And I completely agree, we need to, you know, kickstart the economy, we need to allow countries to trade properly in all areas and have the freedom of movement again to allow people to, you know, tourism, as we spoke earlier about before we got on the call about the Greek Islands, you know, all of this has to have an impact, and I am staying positive that there is that on the horizon for us. But
we need to be positive, Lucy. Yeah. And you know, in every crisis there are also opportunities, so we have to look at the bright side and go ahead and move on, because if we are pessimistic, this will be very bad for our lives. And because you mentioned Greece, I'm very happy with the work our government did.
Yes.
Because they took measures very, very early. And I'm glad to say that we had less than 200 deaths and less than 3,000 cases. Yeah. So Greece is getting back to normality day by day. And we expect to have some tourism this year, because from all the countries nearby Greece, like Italy, like Spain, like Turkey, yeah, where they have a lot of problems right now with the pandemic, Greece is a safe destination. So I hope that the listeners today trust Greece and come here for holidays. It's a very beautiful place, and it's a very safe place.
Yeah.
Taking, of course, the necessary measures, for tourists to come and be safe and enjoy their holidays as they should be.
Absolutely. And you know, we have to have this positive attitude. You have to have, you yourself are a positive man, because you wouldn't have achieved what you had achieved in your career and success, even more to come, without a positive and mindset where we can achieve what we put our minds to achieve. And I thank you, Costis, for...
Like Tony Robbins saying, what you do in life, 80% is psychology and 20% is skills.
Yeah.
And I follow Robbins for many years, and I think he's absolutely right on that.
I like that. It's a good quote to think about. But you know, Costis, thank you. I have to say, on a personal note, you have always been a mentor of mine. I've looked up to you in your career, and you know, think you are an incredible human being as well as, you know, a business leader in your own right. So I've really enjoyed speaking with you today, and for you to share.
I have to say, Lucy, that this is a tradition in family, because your grandfather was my mentor, and I learned a lot of things from him. He's an extremely capable and loving person. He had an amazing career, and we're all very lucky to have him, and learning stuff from him. It's very, very important. So I didn't do something special.
So for everyone listening to our fab conversation today, if you'd like to speak with Costis and his team, if you want to follow him, you can go to his website, which is franman.gr. His Insta handle is just franman. And if you want to find him on Twitter, it's franman_limited. So of course, if you need Costis and his team support in anything to do with what we've talked about today, then please do reach out with him. But Costis, thank you so much for your time today. It's been such a pleasure to see you and to have this chat and this really fascinating insight into your industry.
Thank you, Lucy, so much. I really enjoyed it. It was fun. Thank you.